Good morning, viewers, and welcome to our Saturday talk, the FB Live, which we have been bringing to you very regularly since the lockdown times have happened. And today, the topic is manage anger, do not suppress it. So bringing this talk to you live is Dr. Ali Khwaja, Chairman and Founder of Banjara Academy. Over to Dr. Ali.
Do I look angry? No. But can you make out when a person is angry? Not always. There are some people who are very transparent. One look at their face and you know that, oh my, this guy is angry. Whereas there are so many other people who are angry, but they don't show it. And that is the reason why I think it was old man Aristotle or one of those Greek philosophers who said that getting angry is easy. But how to get angry, when to get angry, with whom to get angry, where to get angry, that is difficult, he said. Let's see whether what he said was true or not. By first understanding what is anger. I am always a stickler that when we take up an issue, when we take up a topic and we want to talk about it, we should be clear about what we are talking about, right? If I define anger differently and if you define anger differently, then there's no point in our having this dialogue, isn't it? So, according to me, you have a right to differ, and in the second half, please put in your comments or whatever, you know, opinions that you have. As far as I am concerned, I look at anger as an emotion. What is an emotion? An emotion is a mental feeling, a state of mind. So we have different types of states of mind, arousal of the mind. We have different mental feelings. We can be happy, we can be sad, we can be angry, we can be afraid, we can be jealous, we can be irritated, we can be thrilled and joyful. So many. Each one of these are emotions. One of those emotions is anger. Now, what and how does anger take place? Basically, anger is an outcome of disappointment, being cheated, being let down, feeling that injustice has been done. So if I feel that I am not getting what is due to me, it could be from an individual, it could be from society, it could be from a group of people, it could be from my own self also. You can be angry with yourself also, isn't it? So, anger is an emotion which generally comes out when we feel that we have been let down, cheated, disappointed, things of that sort. But remember, when I am let down or cheated or disappointed, it is not necessary that I will be angry. Anger is one possible outcome. If I am, let's say, cheated by somebody whom I trusted for a very long time, I had a very high regard for that person. I loved that person. I cared for that person. And that person disappoints me, cheats me, does something bad to me. It is quite possible that I will not feel angry. I will feel sad. I will feel that, why did this person do it to me? I still regard this person. We had very good times together. I still have, you know, appreciate the good things that he or she did. So I may refuse to get angry. Now that brings us to a very important point. Every emotion comes from within. We do not have control over it. Nobody decides that I am going to get angry or I am going to feel happy. No. Without realizing it, before you know it, that anger or whatever emotion wells up from inside you. You have no control over it. But what do you do with that anger once that emotion comes up? What do you do with it is what decides what is going to be the outcome. Probably that is what Aristotle meant. Once you experience a strong emotion like anger, what is it that you do? How do you respond to it? That is what we are going to be discussing today. Both my own anger, if I tend to be angry in certain situations or with certain people, how do I deal with it? And in the same breath, we are also going to be dealing with how do I cope up with somebody else's anger? If there is a person who is a regular part of my life or whom I care for or whom I love or whom I cannot get away from, and that person is an angry person, he or she keeps letting out anger, how do I cope with that sort of a situation? That is both these aspects, we will deal with it. But I come back to the basic description of anger, that anger is something that comes from within because I feel that I have been cheated. It's a possible outcome, not a necessary outcome. Let us be very clear on that. Every time that injustice has been done to me or somebody does something bad to me or somebody disappoints me, it is not necessary that I may feel anger, but in case it comes, and that's what I meant by saying that it comes from within, I have no control. So before I realize it, I am angry with this person. And I feel this person has not been right to me. This person has not done justice. This person has not reciprocated my emotions or whatever I have done for this person. Now I am feeling angry. So then comes the question, how do I bring out that anger? Before we go even further, let me clarify one thing, that there is a world's difference between suppressing anger and managing anger. A lot of people seem to think that suppressing anger takes care of it. No, not at all. In fact, if there is somebody who tells me that I never lose my temper, however bad things happen to me, I never lose my temper, I'm very cautious of that person because he's bottling up that temper. He's like a ticking time bomb. You don't know when he's going to explode. And I don't want to be anywhere close to him when he explodes. So you'll have this person who will say that I don't lose my temper. He's suppressing, 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 and it comes out in the wrong way. In fact, on a lesser note, it happens even on a regular basis with some people. Let's say I work in an environment where I'm not treated well. I feel that justice is not done to me. I'm not given the regard or whatever it is. Some people are very rude to me, customers, boss, whoever it may be. So what is happening? I'm getting angry. And when I'm getting angry, I need to manage my anger. I need to bring it out. No, it's not good for me to carry a negative or a very horrifying emotion like anger with me. But what do? I unconsciously or even consciously maybe sometimes suppress it. I cannot behave badly in the office. I cannot shout at people. I will lose my job or I will lose my dignity or whatever it is. So I spend hours and hours suppressing my anger. And then I come home. And my wife, my child, my pet dog says or does something which is slightly, you know, irritating or bad. And the entire anger comes out on that person. Now, this is what I meant by saying that suppressing anger is not the answer. In fact, it is very bad to keep suppressing anger. And let us also accept the fact that all of us at some time or the other feel angry. Some feel angry to a great extent because we have this strong sense of justice, injustice, what I deserve and all that. The more you focus on yourself, the more you focus on what are my rights, what are my demands, what is it that I should get. When I do something for somebody, I should be getting reciprocation and all these type of things. When I keep thinking that way, no, the possibility of my anger is higher. There are some people who tend to take life a little more easily. The boss is going on shouting and this person listens to his boss's raving, ranting, comes out and tells his colleague, This fellow must have had a tough time with his wife. He's a henpecked fellow. He must be getting a firing from his wife early in the morning, so he comes here and takes it out on his subordinates. See how my anger has come down? What have I done? I have rationalized this situation. I could have taken it very personally and said, I have not done anything wrong. Why is he shouting at me? But I've rationalized it by saying, probably why he's shouting at me is because his wife shouted at him. I can even feel pity or sympathy. Ha, see, here in the office, he's such a big shot. But he must be, you know, such a docile fellow at home. He must be so henpecked, you know, I feel so bad for him. You see how you can manage to divert what would have been an anger situation into a sympathetic situation. And in the end, who feels nice? I feel nice. My boss is an angry person. He keeps on bringing out his temper on all his subordinates. I can't change him, but I can change my own attitude and my own approach to the same issue. To be able to do that, you know what is the first step? The first step is to be able to acknowledge my emotions, whatever the emotions are. Quite often, the precursor to anger is what we refer to as irritation. Sometimes we start getting irritated about small things. My family member does not put away something after using it. It is lying there on the floor. I am a neat and conscientious person. I want to keep the house clean and in order. I don't really get angry, but I get irritated. How many times to tell these people? Yeah, they'll never do it. Maybe I pick it up and put it. Or maybe I just growl at that person and say, you will never learn your lesson or something of that sort. And that's the end of it. But irritation should be a red flag. If you are irritated once in a while, it is fine. But if you find yourself getting irritated quite frequently, then I think it should be a warning sign to you that the irritation is going to pile up and become anger. In fact, guard yourself against irritation of even the smallest and the most understandable things. Okay, somebody in your family is sloppy and you want to keep a neat house and you are getting irritated, at least there is some meaning in it. You live in a metropolitan city where every day there are traffic jams. And you move out at a time when it is peak traffic hour and you have to go through some roads which are highly congested. But when you go onto that road and you find one or two people trying to cut corners and creating more of a traffic jam and blocking the traffic for those extra few seconds, and if you start getting irritated with that, if your mind, instead of being on whatever work you're going to do when you reach the place, or chatting up with whoever else is there in the vehicle, or even sitting and listening to some nice soothing music, if instead of that, your focus goes on that person, look at this stupid fellow, what is he doing? It passes off. If somebody asks you, are you angry? No, yeah, I just get irritated, you know, the way people, educated people, well-to-do people, that fellow was driving such a fancy car, you know, and he doesn't know basic traffic etiquette and things like that. You get away by saying things like that, but I am not happy. I don't think that is the right attitude to just dismiss it, because as I said, that is a precursor. There was a very cute little joke. There was a father who used to drop his little daughter to school every day. He used to drive through, you know, heavy traffic, drop her off at the school and push off. Once the father was out of town and not available to drop the child, so the mother said, I will drive down and take you to school. So the child gets in, the mother starts driving. When she reaches near the school gate, the child is telling the mother, Amma, Amma, 1 minute, don't go. I have a doubt. Is it a holiday today? Amma says, why is it a holiday today? No, Ma, we came so smoothly. There are no stupids and idiots on the road. We just drove so smoothly till here. So maybe schools are closed. See the wisdom of that little child. And I need not comment anything about her father after that. Now, if you were to talk to that father and say, even your little child is noticing these things. Yeah, that's just part of it, you know. I'm a person, see, I maintain perfect discipline, you know. When I am driving, I take care. I never jump signals. I don't cut across to somebody. Why do other people do it? Okay, you want to know why other people do it? Sit down, explore, investigate, and find out. You don't want to do that. You just want to keep making remarks. This is what I'm a little concerned about. People, you know, who are not even aware that they are irritated or they are leading towards anger, or they're already into an anger situation. Every now and then I come across somebody who is actually angry about something. It could be something very important. It could be something frivolous. That's not significant. Please remember that anger is genuine. Anger is something that comes within. You cannot say that you can get angry if you lose 1 million rupees, but you cannot get angry if you lose 100 rupees. If I'm angry, I'm angry. It is not the quantum of the injustice or the disappointment that has come in. We have to acknowledge that. But people can manage anger only if they acknowledge that I've got anger. You see, you can cure a disease, you can go to a doctor only if you acknowledge that, yes, I'm sick. And then you go to the doctor and then the doctor gives you medicine or whatever it is. But if you are in denial and if you say, I'm not sick, what happens? The illness just keeps multiplying. This is also an illness. Something which starts small, but goes on to big, big, big things. If you have not noticed how some people who are very angry people are in total denial, I want to show you a couple of colleagues of mine. They're sitting and discussing something very frivolous, you know, like films or movie or something of that sort. It should have been a very casual transaction between two friends, no? But you will be surprised how suddenly that whole thing takes a turn. Let's put a webcam into their cabin and see what they're talking about.
Meera, I saw a movie yesterday. Ranveer Singh was awesome in that. I'm telling you, he's the best actor in Bollywood nowadays. Not nowadays, I think all time best actor. He is the one and only.
Yeah, but you know what? I think that there are other better ones. Why don't you check out and see some movies? There's Kartik Aaryan, there's Ranveer Singh. I have so many.
No, yaar. Who is all this? They're all bachchu fellows. Don't even compare them with Ranveer Singh. You've seen his hair. You've seen his body. You've seen the way he acts, the emotions that's on his face. He is the one and only. Don't even bother looking at the other movies.
Don't get so serious. I was just giving you my opinion. That's okay. Why getting so angry?
What opinion, man? What opinion are you saying? That is really wrong. Why are you even bothered about other people? When I'm telling you that I know that for sure, I've seen all his movies. I know for sure he is the best, okay? Don't even bother telling me otherwise.
Was Sunita getting angry? What do you think? Sunita is very clear. She says, I'm not getting angry. I'm just giving something which I strongly believe in, that this guy is the best actor. Now, whether Sunita and Meera vote for this person as the best actor or the second best actor, is it going to make a stunning difference in Bollywood? Not at all, no. And yet, there are people like this who take it up so seriously that as though their life depends on it. And this happens every now and then. If you're a keen observer, you will come across people who suddenly seems to be bursting out without any reason and without any, you know, significance to the topic or whatever is happening to them. So I come back to the most important point, that the first level of managing your anger is to acknowledge that I am angry. In fact, there are a lot of people who are continuously angry. Their anger has built up so much that at the drop of a hat, they start shouting or they start saying bad things to people. Now, these people, it's very, very difficult to do something about it because, as I said, they are in denial. A person whom you're saying, come, I'll take you to the doctor will give you medicine and you will feel better. No, I'm not sick at all, so why should I go to the doctor? These are the type of people that we need to, you know, create that awareness that there's nothing wrong with anger. It's perfectly okay to be angry. Anger is like any other emotion, the same way as you're happy, thrilled, joyful, excited, any of those emotions. Anger is also an emotion. But what is important is how do you manage it? According to me, there are two levels at which you need to, you know, manage anger. One is on the spot. If Meera is telling me that so-and-so are equally good actors, whereas I'm a great fan of one particular actor, I need to become aware that because there is a difference of opinion, because Meera feels so strongly about certain other actors who I do not consider to be as great as my hero, anger is going to come in. How am I going to deal with it? The second is that if I find myself getting angry for some frivolous things, like somebody cutting across in traffic, or somebody saying this actor is better than that, or something of that sort, or the fact that one family member has not put the shoes in the correct place, on a long-term basis, I need to work on it. So as I said, there are two, different factors to anger management. One is the immediate one, and the other is the long-term one. So let's start with the immediate one. Anger comes first at the thought level. I am thinking, this person is saying something rude to me. This person is cheating me. This person is making me disappointed. So at the thought level, cognitive level as we call it, can I become aware that I am going towards anger? If I do that, I will respond in a proper manner. I will say, what's the point in arguing with this friend of mine? She's a good friend, she's a colleague. On so many other issues, we have the same opinion and we enjoy discussions. On this one issue of who is the best Bollywood actor or whatever it is, we seem to differ. So why should I discuss that? I'm sure I'll find other people who also, appreciate and admire my hero. So I'll talk to them. I will not talk to this person. So at the thought level, if I can control it, that is the best. If I can't, and I start discussing with my colleague about this colleague, I mean this actor, and I realize that we are hitting into a conflict situation. Now what do I do? The one thing that we can do, which inevitably works, is to put the ball in the other person's court and say, justify it. It can be for anything, wherever possible. Of course, you can't ask the person cutting across on the road to justify, because he'll be gone in a few seconds. But even, let's say, a family member who is a little sloppy, who doesn't keep the house as clean as you would like to keep, and you are only bringing out your anger and shouting at that person. Instead of that, if I can say, why is it that I find your shoe lying outside when you could have just taken it 6 feet away and put it in the rack? Why? When you ask the other person to justify, the person may either think and say, yeah, I know nowadays I'm becoming lazy and I shouldn't be doing that, in which case your anger just fizzles off. The other person may not do that. The other person will say, I'm not the only one doing it. Everybody in the house does it. Why is it that you only shout at me or something? Even when the other person makes a so-called justification, which you do not agree with, you obviously have a very simple logic that just because everybody is doing it, you can't do it. If everybody is cutting red lights, you can't cut the red light. Everybody will create the chaos. So the same thing applies over here, that logically you have a very strong case. But emotionally, if I say that just because other family members are doing it, Why are you doing it? You know what the other person will say? Yeah, but you don't shout at them, you shout only at me. No, I shouted at them also when the other person did this. No, no, that's only once in a while. But with me, you shout every day. Where is the discussion headed? It's getting worse and worse. So when I realized at the speech level that my anger is now coming out, can I at that moment decide that this is not the time and place? This is not the right time to carry out a discussion on keeping shoes in place or who is the best Bollywood hero or whatever is maybe the issue. If even at that point you fail, then the third level is in the action level. Please remember that. There are people who, without realizing, become violent. They cannot control themselves. There are parents, even today in the 21st century, despite behavioral scientists cautioning, warning against capital punishment, they still hit their children. There are highly educated spouses who are otherwise very rational and who live wonderful lives, but yet they indulge in what we refer to as domestic violence. So much of it, you know, going on. There are people who get into brawls on the road. Somebody is cutting corners and this fellow gets out and, you know, goes running to him. And before you know it, they are having a scuffle on the road. Educated person knowing fully well. And as I said, no, when you look at it logically, why am I getting angry? Because he delayed me by 30 seconds by cutting into my path. But I don't mind spending the next 5 minutes or 15 minutes arguing with him, fighting with him, screaming at him. If the objective was to save time, I should have said, I've already lost 30 seconds. Let me now zoom off and make up for the time lost. So you see, the basic purpose goes off. You find people arguing on the road. They get into some argument. And at one point of time, one person asks the other, who do you think you are? The other fellow says, what? Who do you think you are? No, what do you think of yourself? What do you think of yourself? You think you are some great fellow? What? You think you are some governor? What were they discussing? They were discussing whether I have parked my car correctly or whether, you know, I should not have made that statement or whatever it is. But we are going into this long drawn out argument on who do you think you are and what do you think you are. Whatever I may think I am, how does it make a difference to the issue? That is what happens. And that again can lead to violence, unpleasantness, so many things, isn't it? So at these three levels, we need to be very conscious and we need to control ourselves. Simple things like count to 10, have a glass of water. Just tell that person, I'll just put on the fan, it's getting very warm in this room. Or pulling up a chair and saying, come, let's sit down here and let's talk about it. Within those 10 seconds, you will realize that your response is better than what it would have been if you had reacted instead of responded. And on a longer basis, this is referred to as, you know, when you have a more serious problem, what we can do is sleep over it. Ask for one day's time. Tell the person, today I don't want to respond. We will continue this discussion tomorrow. I will give you my opinion tomorrow. Sleep over it. Yoga, meditation, deep breathing, prayers, mantras, all of these help. You have to find your own way. Sometimes punching a bag helps some people. So to bring down your anger level at that moment, you have to find ways and means. But it can be done, and if you start off, you can make it a habit. And once it becomes a habit, it becomes so easy. It happens at the subconscious level. You don't even have to make an effort. But what comes out of it is that conflict reduces, anger reduces, you have more peace of mind and things of that sort. So while you think of how to go about it, please remember that anger is one of the greatest enemies of mental health. good mental health can be destroyed because of anger. Now, being conscious of that, we have a little idea and approach on mental health. Will you listen to my colleague Seema for just a minute on what we are doing in the area of mental health?
Hi everyone. Thank you for coming in Saturday after Saturday. So here I just wanted to tell you that on 10th of October is the World Mental Health Day. So we will of course have an FB live from 11 to 12 on mental health. Dr. Ali will be taking us through that talk. But what we will do starting 3rd of October is on our Facebook, Instagram and other places, we will start putting short videos on good mental health, which Dr. Ali will be taking us through. So there'll be these videos which talk about good mental health. There'll be various topics like having a good sense of humor or, decision making or positive mental health. So there will be these short topics leading us starting from 3rd of October to the Mental Health Day, which is on 10th. So we'll be doing a Facebook Live on that day. So we will see you all and keep introspecting and, thinking about these topics starting from 3rd to 10th. So over to Dr. Ali again. You can now start putting in your comments and questions.
Before I start answering your questions, let me also tell you about the second part of the thing. That is, if you find yourself getting irritated, angry, even if it's suppressed anger, even if you're not really shouting at people or something, but if you do find yourself, getting that anxiety, that, irritation or being upset and not being very happy, wanting to burst out at someone and having to control yourself all the time and things of that sort. If you find yourself in that situation, please look at long-term means of dealing with anger. Anger of that sort is directly connected to stress. Your stress levels are high and that is turning into anger. The smallest thing is irritating you, upsetting you, and that is what is leading to all these things. So I will not tell you that this is a method, that is a method, and this is the right way, and that is the right way. It depends on your temperament. It depends on your value system. It depends on your attitudes. So you have to find out what is the best method. We have with us in Banjara a long list of, ways and means to tackle anger. We'll put it up on the website. So that any one of you can log into the website and you can just go through that list. But that is only a representative list. You have to select out of that. And also remember, you have to do it by trial and error. Try out one means. It doesn't work. Do it for a few days. And don't say, I tried it for 3 days and it didn't work. Do it for 2-3 weeks. Because this is a long-term benefit that I'm talking about. It will transform your life. It will help you for the rest of your life. So 2 weeks, 3 weeks, try out. So I have found this method. Somebody told me about this type of meditation or this yoga or this, punching the bag or doing gardening or whatever it is. Try it out for a sufficient number of days. If it doesn't work, start off. In fact, parallel, start off another activity, third activity. Slowly you will find which is the one which is most suitable to you and you will be able to deal with it. And the same thing applies to be able to handle other people's anger. If that person is open to it, you can gently tell the person, this is what you need to do. But if that person is very close, the person is not even willing to listen to you, then you have to develop ways and means how you can mentally or emotionally insulate yourself. You may not be able to physically get away from that person, but it's not at all difficult if you make it a habit to mentally get away from that person, emotionally get away from that person. do it, it works. Not always, I cannot make such lofty claims, but it works in a number of times. It's worth it for your own joy and fulfillment and happiness. Do not allow your anger to upset relationships. Do not be at the receiving end of somebody's anger if it goes on, because in the long run, it will affect you as much as it is affecting the other person. Okay? So, now what do we do? How to manage anger with moody people? You don't realize suddenly mood changes. That's what I'm saying. Find out what are the triggers. On the day-to-day basis, find out what are the triggers. If you talk to him about his mother, he gets very irritated. He's got very strong political leanings. So the moment you talk against his political party, he gets very aggravated. Or for some reason, he feels that if these shoes are not kept in the rack, he gets very irritated. So find out the triggers and move on that. And then if that person is close to you and willing to talk to you, when the person is in a good mood, not when the person is angry, sit down and say, the other day things became a little unpleasant. I noticed that, you know, we were having a nice evening and we were sitting and chatting, but things became a little unpleasant. I wanted to know how we can get around with this situation. Can I help you in some way? Would you like to try out something so that, you know, we do not have this unpleasantness which we are going through? Do try it. Not once, but try it a number of times. So like Rekha says, how do we make a person aware of his anger who is in denial mode? How we should not make aware is what Meera tried to do just now. Don't get angry, man. Never say that. The moment you say don't get angry, that person's anger shoots up. In fact, one of the good ways, you know, is to say, yes, Sunita, I can see that you're getting very angry because you seem to be so committed to this hero of yours. Put that label and acknowledge it and accept it. Yes, you feel so strongly that I can understand that you're getting very angry when somebody suggests that he's not the best guy. Now you see how the situation changes. And then, when there is no argument going on, that is the time to talk about it and say that I have noticed that every time we are discussing about your hero or about your political affiliations or about the family or something of that sort, it seems to be causing you a lot of stress. Don't even say anger. It seems to be causing you a lot of stress, which is a fact. You're not telling a lie. The stress is converting itself and coming out in the form of anger. So say that I find that you're getting under stress. I would like to help you. Can we do something about it? Put it that way and try it out. Gauri says, what is value system? You just referred to deal with anger, also refers to value system. Yes. Supposing I feel that there are certain basic values, you know, that you should not cheat somebody, you should not bribe somebody, you should not do something of that sort. And you find that the other person's value system is totally different. He says, we can pay a bribe and get away with it. Or, you know, it's okay to hit the child or something. Or it's okay to be very cruel with a subordinate or a domestic servant or something of that sort. So those are the basic values which most of us have. If there is something which is going against your values, be aware of that, because there it's going to be very, very difficult to even work with that person to come to some compromise. What you said is absolutely right. Anger management purely depends on individual, how to have control based on the intensity. Don't worry about the intensity in the first place. The moment you become aware, even if it's at a very minor intensity level, nip it in the bud. Start working on these things. Teach your children. Children imbibe anger from their, you know, important adults like parents or whoever it is. So teach your children. Even if you tend to get short-tempered inside the house or your child is watching that, tell the child, yes, I got very irritated and angry and that is what made me shout at so-and-so in the house. I think that is wrong. And I've developed this habit. I'm working on it. And I want you also to work on it so that you don't imbibe it. Secondly, point it out to me and show me that, you know, you seem to be very angry. So maybe sometimes I'm in denial. I will learn from that. Children can make wonderful partners in this process of healing and improving. Okay, brief me how to get away from negative people who make us angry. Get away. If you can physically get away, nothing like it. You have one or two people in the office or somebody who are very irritating and this and that. you make up your mind that I will not have anything to do with this person as far as possible. What official work I have to do, I will do that. Whatever meetings I have to attend together or where I have to interact, I will do it. But not one word after that. And even in those interactions, I will not say anything personal so that that person cannot use it as an excuse to hit up me. The problem lies not when you have the opportunity to get away from people. Most of the problem lies when it is people from whom you cannot get away. They're so close to you that physically you have to literally live with them on a day-to-day basis. Those are the more challenging ones, as I mentioned to you a little while back. How far is true? People who are angry speak the truth. No, there's nothing like that. People who are angry can either speak the truth, or people who are angry can twist the truth totally out of context and, you know, bring out something which is absolute nonsense also and get away with the thing. Here, I wanted to tell you one important thing. You know, you have these wonderful people who lose their temper, who shout, scream, become violent, whatever they do. And then, you know what they do? They tell the victim, why do you make me so angry? Why do you make me so angry? I'm sorry I shouted and I didn't like it. I don't want to do it. I think it was hard. But why do you make me angry? Now, even when I'm apologizing, I'm making it clear that you are the person who instigated me. Be careful of such people. They can influence your mind. They can make you think, I made him or her angry. I'm the guilty person. I instigated. That's not true at all. Sometimes people do things intentionally by which you get irritated. Yes, that is what I'm saying. Right from school bullies and, you know, people who tease children. I am wearing specs. I'm the only guy wearing specs in my class. And somebody starts off by saying, four eyes. Okay, pa, you guys have only two eyes. I've got four. Hey, I'm much better than you. That's it. It's the end of the story. But if I turn around and say, what do you mean four eyes? Why are you saying that? I don't like it. I will complain. I'm in for it. The same thing carries into adulthood. When people realize that you get irritated, that you get upset, it becomes a game. They purposely try to irritate you. So you have to look inward instead of looking at it. If it is not this person, somebody else will irritate me. Sometimes you suppress anger, later become depression, leading to aggression. Yes, that's what I'm saying. When you suppress anger, it can lead to depression. It can lead to a loss of self-esteem. Your motivation can go away. So many things can happen if you keep suppressing anger. Do hypertensive people get more angry? I'll tell you a very interesting story that happened long back. I was driving on a narrow road, you know, where there was no place to overtake. And there was this lady driving in front of me, was going very slow. Now, somehow I wanted to ask her that just give a little space and I will, you know, move on. After blowing the horn for quite a bit of time, the moment I found an opportunity, I started overtaking that car. The lady is driving, an elderly gentleman, I presume must have been her father or father-in-law, he was sitting on the side, even though driving the car. When I'm overtaking, he turns to me and starts shouting at me. Why are you wrong? Can't you see this? I got a little surprised. And I ignored him. And over him, I told the lady, the driver, get his blood pressure checked. She burst out laughing. She said, we are going to the doctor to get his blood pressure checked. It is a fact. Hypertension definitely aggravates. It's not a cause of anger. But whatever anger you have in you gets definitely aggravated. Get your blood pressure under control. That's one of the first things to do. Now, anger lead me to self-harm because of suppression. Yes, I agree with Harita that many a time, if you keep suppressing, you actually land up with, you know, harming yourself more than anybody else. In spite of our best efforts or the method that you have just mentioned, some people are not willing to listen or even try to understand. Then how do we deal with these people? Yes, you try your best. You put in consistent effort. Don't give up after trying out once or twice or something of that sort. After putting in consistent effort and this person is not doing it, then you have to tell yourself that I have to bring about a change in myself. And what could be that change? The first thing could be, can I keep away from him? Can I move out from there? Can I take a transfer from this office? Or can I move away from this person and not live under the same roof? Whatever it is, physically. If that is not possible, then as I told you, how can I mentally insulate myself from that person? Like the guy who said that his wife must be shouting at him, that's why he comes and shouts at me. So I can't get away from my boss, but I am mentally insulating. There are various ways and means. I'm not going into the details right now, but if you actually make an effort, and if you're consistent and if you're persistent, over a period of time, you can come to that mental state where that other person's anger, or you know, the way the other person behaves, does not have the same emotional impact on you as it is happening now. How to get insulated from someone who's closely related and have bipolar disorder? Bipolar disorder is a very serious disorder, as you know. It is one of the two major psychotic ailments, the first one being schizophrenia, the other is bipolar disorder. A person who is going through bipolar disorder and is symptomatic in the sense that he keeps shouting, he keeps screaming, he is restless all the time, he's attacking people and all that, that person needs medication. There is no other shortcut to it. You have to use all your efforts and ways and means to first treat that disorder of that person. Until that happens, the person will continuously behave in a very, very unacceptable and irrational manner. It's extremely difficult to live with a symptomatic person who has schizophrenia or bipolar disorder. Once you can do that, you yourself will find that the person has come down to much more peaceful and much more better behavior, and you can rebuild your relationship with that person. Bobby says, children must learn to manage anger. No, Bobby, children should not learn to manage anger. We should learn to manage our own anger and be good role models and thereby teach the children. Let's not pass the buck on to children. Sometimes some of them don't accept that they are angry and it's very difficult. That's what I've been telling you for since such a long time. When they do not accept it, don't keep drilling in that point or bring it from some other angle by saying, not saying that you are angry, but saying you are under stress. I think you're undergoing a lot of stress because of the things that you are facing, and I can understand that that is leading to a lot of irritation and things of that sort. I'd like to help you come in as a rescuer. Try every possible means. Anger should be always expressed, and I feel the best way to do it is to keep quiet, and with practice we can achieve it, especially with people who irritate you for no reason. Keeping quiet at that moment, yes, definitely helps us. No, but you cannot keep quiet all the time, and you have to bring it out in some manner or the other. Maybe even with that person, instead of keeping quiet, if I were to make a statement by saying, you may have a point there, I need some time to think over, I'll get back to you. You almost acknowledge that his anger is justified and the person is, you know, feeling very good with himself. But at the same time, you have not said yes. Maybe some other time when he is in a better mood, you can make an attempt to say, that day you seem to be very emotional. See, that is what I'm saying. When you say angry, the person retorts. You are emotional, you are under stress, you know, you are facing a lot of challenges. So I felt I need to discuss this with you. Is this a good time to talk about it? That sort of thing. Navina says, due to victim feeling, we get angry. How to overcome that? Overcome that victim feeling. There's no victim in this world. There are only survivors. If you choose to be a victim, you will be a victim the rest of your life. If you define yourself as a survivor, I am a survivor of so-and-so's anger. I am a survivor of injustice. I am a survivor of the cruel behavior of so-and-so person. Again, as I've been telling, it boils back to coming back to your own self and working on your own self. This is a good one. How do you deal with people who are always calm? Why do you want to deal with them? Be happy, no? There are very few people like that. As long as I told you, that person is not suppressing anger. So if despite all the ups and downs, if there is this person who has learned to be calm, and we do have people like that. I come across so many people who have learned. Many senior citizens, for example, there'll be an old grandmother who has seen so much of ups and downs and so much of unpleasantness in life. that anything happens and she just smiles and she remains calm, or she starts chanting some mantra or something of that sort. They learned how to cope with very, very difficult situations. You must congratulate them, you must tell them how much you appreciate them, and you must try to imbibe whatever techniques and methods they have used to make themselves so calm. Now, someone who meditates for hours together but comes out and starts shouting at the mother or whatever it is. Yes, that's what I said. Every technique does not suit every person. If you mechanically say that meditation is the answer, prayer is the answer, yoga is the answer, or whatever it is, and because others have benefited from it, you start doing it, it does not help. This person has to realize, or somebody has to gently make the person realize that while I do appreciate that you are meditating for hours, you are investing so much of your time and energy into improving yourself, somewhere, you know, you are not being able to get what you want. That is a good relationship with your mother or mother-in-law. There is still conflict happening. So can you try out some different methods? Can I help you in that? Can you sit and tell me what are the triggers? What makes you so upset against your mother, and what brings about this conflict? That is how you need to help that person to explore other alternatives. How to avoid from getting into an argument? First is ask for time. If you feel that this argument is going to get unpleasant or something of that sort, I said, no, count to 10 or, you know, sleep over it or something of that sort. Prepare your points very well. Convey it to that person, this is what I feel, whether you agree or you do not agree. I don't want to get into an argument. Make it very clear to that person. How to not get angry when someone offends us? Nobody can offend us, Kavya. We get offended. Ganeshi said that. It's not my words. Person can say the nastiest things to you. A fellow standing on the road who's got bipolar disorder. Everybody in the whole locality knows he's suffering from bipolar disorder. And he is right now in that, you know, phase which they refer to as the hyper or the manic phase. And he looks at you when you are walking by and abuses you in the worst possible language. Do you get offended? No, you don't. Why? Because you realize that this man has got nothing against you. It is not my personal thing. I am not that person, whatever he is trying to describe. Poor fellow, he's got a disorder, so let him go. Even Jesus Christ said, no, forgive them, O Lord, because they don't know what they are saying. That's the type of attitude. I mean, you don't have to be so highly spiritual or so great sacrificing, but you do need to learn the skill of empathy, which helps you to understand that many of these people who offend, many of these people who are angry and all that, are basically disgruntled people within themselves. They are looking for a soft target and you happen to be there. It is like that angry street dog, and just because you are passing by, he is barking at you. He doesn't know who you are and how to select whom to bark at. You just need to protect yourself in case that person is violent. But as they say, barking dogs don't bite. And that is what happens with human beings also. Angry human beings do not, most of the time, they don't bite. They are just getting their anger out. Violent people are there, but they are a minority and they are a different category altogether. Few people are always bursting with anger any point of time. How to lead? That's what I said. On the long term, if that person is open, help that person to understand that probably your stress levels are high. Maybe you're facing challenges. Maybe so and so has been bad to you. And I want to help you. I'm your well-wisher. Don't talk about the outbursts and all that. Talk only about the person's, whatever the stresses and this and that the person is going through. If the person is open to it, you can work with it. If the person says, no, I am right, I have a right to shout and scream and this and that, then work on what I was mentioning a little earlier, that is to insulate yourself. Yeah. I get irritated at small things. How do I deal with it, is asking Pushpa. Yeah. If you are getting constantly irritated, that means whatever is happening are only triggers to whatever is there deeper inside you. My career may not be going well. I'm not in a happy job, or I feel so many years that I put in have not given me results because I don't connect it up. But when somebody says the smallest thing, I get irritated. Or my health is bad. I'm suffering from blood pressure, as I told you, or I'm having some diabetes or some long drawn out ailment which has been bugging me, I mean, and out of doctors and all that. Now, obviously, I will feel irritated. So go into the cause of what makes me so irritated that it keeps coming out on a regular basis. How to deal with people who say, no problem, this will not happen again, and do the same thing. The moment the person says, no problem, this will not happen again, pull out a little notebook, open that and say, kindly write it down with today's date. And next time that happens, just open the same notebook and say, can you write on the next page the same thing, that this will not happen again? I mean, I'm trying to simplify it, but the idea behind it is to help you understand that there are very simple, very easy ways and means. If you have control over yourself, if you are a little patient, if you are consistent, and if you have that empathy to understand the other person, it works to greater or lesser extent. Dolly rightly says, victim thinking can sometimes be due to lack of assertiveness, it could be due to low self-esteem, there are various causes for it. But the bottom line is, never take up the victim role. Always say that I'm a survivor, never say that I'm a victim. These are the type of things, you know, day in and day out, I'm sure many of us face. Quite a few of us have learned on our own or the hard way or by experience how to deal with these sort of situations and are dealing with it beautifully. I come across such persons, you know, who have taught me a lot of lessons about how they have overcome very, very difficult interpersonal situations, anger situations, where they have managed to control their own anger and irritation, where they have helped other important people to overcome and to develop much better you know, relationships. Whenever you come across somebody like that, learn from that person. When a person says that, you know, I used to have a lot of fights with my mother, but now I think I am better, sit down and make that person talk. I used to get so angry, you know, the way my mother used to do this. Or vice versa, that my mother used to be perpetually angry with me, but now I have a better relationship. Try out all the possible means which other people have done. And we can learn lessons from each other in that way. I'm getting a few thank you messages. Let me acknowledge collectively to each one of you that it's not just that I am doing you a favor and that you need to thank me. This is something which I strongly believe in and which I like to do, because I learn a lot when I interact. I learn a lot when somebody asks questions or when somebody says something. So as has been written just now, you can continue to interact with me by sending me a mail. Just be a little patient. Again, don't get angry that I sent him a mail and then last 2 hours he has not replied. People do that with me. I don't even look at my mail more than once in a day, or sometimes not even once in a day. So be a little patient and don't get angry with me. I will certainly reply to any issue that comes to you. And I think you are aware of the fact that we do free counseling. It's not just me. We have this wonderful team in Banjara. We do email counseling. We do it on the phone. We do it in person. Each one of our counselors are very, very committed people who give their free service. And I love the fact that whatever little we can do, we are doing and we will continue doing to make the society and the world around us a little better place. And with that, let me hand you again for the last time back to Seema for just a minute to wind up this session and tell you one or two very important announcements. Thank you very much and see you soon again. Bye-bye.
All right. So again, an excellent session by Dr. Ali. Okay, I just wanted to tell you that Ali has written these different emotions, different booklets on emotions, managing anger. Many of those practical tips are all mentioned here. Many other emotions like jealousy and handling your emotions, emotional honesty, and so on and so forth. So you can walk into our center and buy any of these booklets. They're very practical and they're good tips that you can practice. One or two other, I mean, there's always so much happening in Banjara. I don't know what to tell you and what not to. So please keep a track of whatever is happening on our website, all the dates and different. So we have camps, we have workshops, we have classes, we have counseling. There's a whole lot of things that's happening. The immediate one, which is coming up next weekend on 2nd of October to 3rd of October, we have a camp on finding inner happiness. In Manthan, that's a retreat we have near DPS North. So if you want, and anybody is welcome to come and attend that. So you're most welcome. If you want to register for that and ask, you know, more details, please call up our office. It's an excellent camp. We'll do a lot of activities related to finding inner happiness, Dr. Ali's session, and lots of other things planned. And like I was telling you about the mental health day, so we will have a Facebook Live on 10th of October, mental health key to success, right? And then on 15th of October, we have our helping hand talk on ego in relationships. So I'm sure that is also one topic of interest to you. And as you know, helping hand talk is happens every third Thursday. And all of you are invited to our training house here in RT Nagar. You're most welcome to bring in your family, friends, and everybody and come and attend the talk. So lots of this and much more happening at Banjara. And I will have to tell you about the DCS course also. And many of you are DCS students in the current batches. And, you know, some of you are ex-DCS students. And for those who want to know more about this course, so already we have launched three of our batches. You know, and the last batch for the year 2021 will be launched by the end of this month. So if you want to know more about that, DCS is, of course, Diploma in Counseling Skills is a program not just to become a counselor and obviously reach out to others, but a lot of self-growth and development. So you may not want to change your career and become a counselor or whatever, but if you want to learn all these, you know, these emotions that we talk about, you know, for your emotional, you know, managing yourself emotionally well, and all that can happen in our DCS program. It's a 1 year part-time program. So this is the last and final call, I would say, and soon we'll be closing admission for the year. So if you are interested, please get in touch with us and we'll be more than happy to tell you about the program. So see you all for, I think, not the next Saturday, the Saturday after that on 10th of October on mental health. Bye-bye. Take care.